Good afternoon, students. I welcome you all to the introductory lecture on Geotechnical Engineering 2 of EDUSET program. I am S.K. Prasad from S.J. College of Engineering, Mysore. In this lecture, my main intention is to help you to understand the basics of geotechnical engineering and its application. So here I concentrate on telling you where all you can apply geotechnical engineering. I want to tell you that somehow geotechnical engineering has taken secondary step among your studies, but unless you have a strong base of geotechnical engineering, any future study of civil engineering will not be useful. So in this regard, so the basic learning outcome in this lecture will be on understanding what is geotechnical engineering and its importance. All of you know that the present day requirement is the infrastructure development, and civil engineering plays an important role there. Name any facility, it is the civil engineers who arrive first, and we can't build structures in air, at least as of now. We need to build it on a stable ground. That is when the geotechnical engineers come. So geotechnical engineering is the most essential ingredient of any civil engineering construction. You are seeing the pictures of various infrastructural requirements, starting from tall towers to steel structures to heavy vehicles to the train transport and even the underground metro transport. All of them will have to be built on ground, for which you need to see whether the ground is stable. That is when the geotechnical engineers come into picture. So geotechnical engineering involves understanding the soil, ensuring that the structure and soil act together, and soil provides both stability and durability to structure. Please note, without experiencing shear failure and excessive settlement. This is what is basic geotechnical engineering. As I mentioned, for any infrastructure, geotechnical engineer plays an important role. You have a structure which has to be resting on ground, and what we look at is how the ground behaves, how the ground takes the load. And you can see many of the infrastructural requirements, like the bridges, the retaining walls, all of them need the knowledge of soil. A typical engineering project involves with geotechnical engineering. So what we do is to prepare the ground first for any constructional activity. So at the construction site, first thing done is to take out a sample of soil, do investigations either there at the construction site or in the laboratory, and all these tests will help in determining the soil properties which are used in the design office to find whether the given soil is capable of taking the load, to design the structure to take care of the forces coming. And this is a routine important test, including soil sample extraction, determination of soil properties, and those design details go to the field for the construction purpose. If you look at geotechnical engineering, it is not all about foundations alone. There are many aspects, and these days the horizon of geotechnical engineering has enhanced considerably, from foundation engineering to deep excavations. You might be knowing, in urban cities we need to go for not structures above ground, structures below ground, cellars of different floors. So you need to make deep excavations, where the knowledge about how to excavate is very important. How to keep the soil stable when excavated is even more important. Then tunneling is required. We are going in for metros in all our urban places, and good methodology of tunneling without troubling the existing structures, existing buildings, is important. Wherever you go for any infrastructure, you require retaining walls, you have slopes which need to be understood whether they are stable or not, and you need embankments for the purpose of dams, for the purpose of highways and several such things. Environmental geotechnics is there, earthquake geotechnical engineering is there, and also building structures under difficult situations. Like in Karnataka, we have expansive soils, we have marine clay, we have soils of high compressible nature, and how to build those. These days you can't discard a particular site just because it is bad. In that situation you need to improve the ground. All of them come under the family of geotechnical engineering. As I mentioned, a structure which is in direct contact with soil, a structure in which you need the knowledge of soil also, the knowledge of the properties of soil which help in the structural structure acting as a unit are required. So in that regard, structures like foundations, embankments, earth dams, retaining walls, slopes, deep excavations, tunnels, reinforced earth, geotextiles, all of them can be called as geotechnical structures where you require the knowledge of soil also. If you take foundations, foundations can be either shallow or deep. A shallow foundation is one in which the foundation is placed at shallow depth where you have firm ground available at shallow depth. In the picture you can see the foundation provided at shallow depth below the ground level, and also a typical picture, a photograph of a shallow foundation. The foundations are required to transfer the forces from the superstructure to a firm soil below. If at all at shallow depth soil is not good enough, then you need to go for deep foundations. In that case, the loads are transferred not to the weak soil below but to bedrock or hard soil which is at great depth below. You can see the picture of a pile foundation which is a popular deep foundation. In these pictures you show the construction of pile foundation. Each pile will have to be either driven or bored into the ground, for which you require equipments. And what you see here is an equipment to drive the pile, then the pile being driven, and then you have a set of piles which are already driven into the ground. In geotechnical engineering, another important problem is settlement. As I mentioned earlier, the job of a geotechnical engineer is not just to look at the safety against failure, but also to see that there are not much of settlements. Two classical settlement problems I always tell our students are, one, the problem in Mexico clay, where the buildings not just settle, they disappear, they experience what we call a subsidence. So every year there could be settlement of the order of a meter, and what you see in the first picture is the Palace of Fine Arts in Mexico, where uniform settlement of the order of 2 to 3 meters has been experienced. The other picture all of you are very much aware of, Leaning Tower of Pisa. If that tower were not to be leaning, maybe you wouldn't have known this structure. It is leaning because of what we call as differential settlement. Please note that we need to avoid both uniform settlement and differential settlement, or keep them well within limits. That is the job of geotechnical engineers. As I mentioned earlier, there are many difficult soils. One such difficult soil is expansive clay. In this soil, any structure built may experience the lifting up or bringing it down alternatively. So this soil swells and shrinks depending on the absorption of water and release of water, and causes huge problems particularly to light structures. Then you have the problem of retaining walls. You need to retain earth at two different levels, and many a times this is to be provided for highways, you need to provide retaining walls for swimming pools. You need to provide retaining walls for basic structures where you will be retaining earth at two different levels. What happens is earth on one side will exert a pressure on the wall, and you need to design this wall to take the lateral load from earth. As a geotechnical engineer, you need to decide how much lateral load the structure is going to experience, and the calculations on that will depend on the type of the soil. Then you have earth dams. Dams built completely out of earth. So you need to bring earth from a different place, a burrow portion, and transport it to the place where the embankment is to be built, and then place the embankment. Please note that the job of an embankment, especially a dam, is number one, to hold the water on one side without allowing any leakage. Two, water exerts pressure on it, lateral pressure, and it has to stand without undergoing any instability or failure. So an earth dam will consist of clay core at the center. The objective of providing the core is to see that the permeability is as minimum as possible, but that itself is not sufficient because it is not very strong. To strengthen on the sides, you require the shell, which is mainly of granular material. The objective is to give stability against the lateral force, and all this are put on the ground. So the subsoil should be safe and strong to take the load of the embankment. So you can see a canal where on either side there are embankments provided. The objective is to hold soil on one side, hold earth on the other side. In addition to earth dams, you might have concrete dams. Concrete dams, you might say, well, they are the structural elements. But please note, as I mentioned earlier, these dams will have to be built on ground. So the subsoil plays an important role. The first thing we need to do is to see whether the subsoil is okay. Then we need to evaluate the load transferred by the concrete dam. It is not just the vertical load. The concrete dam on one side will have the reservoir, and reservoir will apply horizontal force, and the entire system should be stable, for which subsoil should be capable enough to take this load, capable enough to take the moments transferred by the lateral load. So a geotechnical engineer plays an important role in deciding the safety and capability of the subsoil. Any construction requires earthwork. Earthwork involves excavation. Earthwork involves even building up embankments. Here in the pictures, you see the excavation being done. It is not just the horizontal excavation. Sometimes we may have to make deep excavations. So deep excavations involve cutting, and when you cut earth, you know, earth consists of particulate materials. They cannot stand by themselves. They will lose their stability. That is where you have the danger, and you will have to be extremely careful on this regard. The next topic which is of importance to geotechnical engineers is reinforced earth. Maybe in this course you don't study about it, but what I want to tell you is that this is perhaps the best finding in civil engineering in the last century. Earlier people were telling that pre-stressed concrete is perhaps the new invention, but once reinforced earth walls came into picture, they took over, and for every problem associated with geotechnical engineering, reinforced earth or its counterpart geotextile has a solution. So what you see on the picture are different types of walls built for the purpose of retaining earth. I mentioned earlier that you build retaining walls. Retaining walls may be made of masonry, may be made of RCC, which involve those materials, and they are generally expensive because you need to build a firm foundation. If the soil, subsoil below is not good, then you may have to go deep, and hence the cost of the foundation increases. But with reinforced earth, the beauty is you don't have to think of a conventional foundation. And here, even an ordinary preparation of the subsoil to take up the extra earth on top of it is sufficient. You don't have any structure. The only thing you do is to have geotextile materials, which we call them as reinforcements, and use them as shown here. I don't go very deep into the subject here, but only thing I want to say is that this subject, this structure has changed the course of geotechnical engineering. And most of our structures where you have the flyovers and where you have the abutments, all of them right now are being built out of this technique. I was talking about deep excavations. Deep excavations are necessary for the construction underground. They are necessary for construction of cellars in the buildings. You can't just blindly excavate, because as I mentioned earlier, soil is particulate, soil also contains water, and it might cause instability. So one of the ways of protecting the instability is by this approach called soil nailing. What is done here is that steel rods are pierced into the soil, and then the entire area is grouted. Those steel rods, which are pierced horizontally at some spacing, both in horizontal and vertical directions, they give stability to the wall. They give stability to the soil and see to it that the soil does not fall. So soil nailing is an important technique, particularly for deep excavations, to stabilize and to keep the lateral wall stable. The other type of geotechnical structure is sheet pile. Mostly in the waterfront structures, sheet piles play an important role. Sheet piles are nothing but retaining walls built out of sheets of steel. They are interlocked together. Sometimes even timber may be used. The objective here is to retain earth at two different levels. You can see in the picture the sheet pile being provided. So this is a sheet pile, and earth is at two different levels. Quite naturally, earth at higher elevation will exert a horizontal force. The objective is to see that this sheet pile is stable and it can withstand the horizontal load. Mainly it is provided offshores in harbor structures, and you can see the ship being parked next to the sheet pile. So this entire region is something like a wharf or a dock. Sheet piles are used for different purposes. As I mentioned, mainly their objective is to resist the lateral earth pressure exerted by wall on the higher side. They are used in excavations. They are used in many waterfront structures. Sometimes they are also used as temporary structures. The objective is to retain earth at two different levels for some time during construction, and immediately after the construction they can be removed and reused in a different place. Normally they have an interlocking section in such a way that one sheet is connected with the next one, so that they act integrally as one single mass, single unit. Cofferdams are temporary constructions. They are generally constructed out of sheet piles. They enclose a particular area. The objective is something like construction of foundation in waterfront areas. Say in a river you would like to build a bridge. There you need to build a pier. And how do you build pier? You cannot build pier in water straight away. So you need to divert the water and keep the construction site free from water. One methodology is to build cofferdam which consists of sheet piles enclosing an area. So you can notice here sheet pile wall is being built here. Likewise you build on this side as well as this side and enclose this entire area. And this area is free from water and you can be pumping out water continuously and you can keep this entire area dry. The advantage is you can do the constructions without the presence of water, which means there is no problem with the quality. So once the building is built, in this case the foundation is built, the sheet pile can be removed and the same sheets can be reused for a different purpose later on. So cofferdams are the normally temporary structures. The other problem with the geotechnical engineers is slope. You know, a slope may be man-made, a slope may be natural, and the objective is that under any situation slope should not fail. You can notice here that in the first picture the building is precariously placed. It never used to be the case before one force called earthquake happened here. The ground was stable, but the effect of earthquake was to cause this entire slope to become unstable and slope failed. Huge mass of soil falls down from the upstream to the downstream. Why will that slope fail? Slope was stable initially under normal load, but this extra load created by the earthquake made the ground weak and hence slope became unstable. And the slope can fail due to various other causes like heavy rainfall. It may be due to glacier. It may be due to man-made problems like sudden cuttings. So what happens? A mass of soil from upstream will come down heavily. So the downstream will be a sufferer. At the same time, when the slope becomes unstable, continuously from here the mass comes down. So even the upstream structures will be in danger. As a geotechnical engineer, our job is to keep the slope stable. So we need to assess what is the strength of the present slope. Is it well within limits? And if at all unprecedented forces like heavy rainfall, like earthquake occur, then will the slope be stable? That is what we need to assess. So basically it is the sheer strength of the soil which holds it from falling down. So we will have to see whether the stresses caused due to these unprecedented forces will be much bigger than the sheer strength. So big failures of slopes are normally called as landslides, and landslides are common in mountainous areas. And if you see places like Himalayan mountains, you will always have one landslide or the other troubling the civilization. So the stability of landslides, stability of slopes will have to be looked after by the geotechnical engineers. These are some pictures showing the failure of slopes. For instance, in the first picture you can notice the mass having come down. So naturally this road will be in trouble under the landslide, And here in the second picture, you can again notice it is the aerial view. You have the road and this entire slope is disturbed. Also in this picture, you can see greenery all round, but only this much portion, the slope became unstable and entire mass here has come down, uprooting the greenery also. Of course, there is no civilization here, but if there were to be buildings here, they would have been totally unstable. So keeping the slopes stable, maintaining their intact nature is one of the objectives of a geotechnical engineer. I talked about deep excavation earlier also. Here I show in some pictures, you can notice that this is an urban area, lot of buildings are there. There used to be some building here and the area is now demarcated for a new building. The objective is to make excavation. Can you simply make blind excavations close to the next building? Definitely not, because the ground here will not be stable. It cannot stand by itself. In addition, it is carrying some heavy load. So the entire wall here will be unstable and there is a lateral force exerted by the soil which makes it unstable, and if this falls, you know the consequence on these buildings. Therefore, whenever deep excavations are made, sufficient propping, sufficient supporting of the exposed walls is essential. As a geotechnical engineer, our objective is to find out what is the lateral force exerted, and based on that lateral force, we need to decide how much or what type of propping and supporting system we need to provide. And here also in the other picture, you can notice the deep excavations made close to a tall building. Quite naturally, a tall building will carry enormous amount of force, and this force will transform into lateral force on the wall, on the excavated portion, which will destabilize that excavated portion. So some kind of a propping is necessary. All of you know that Karnataka is going to have metro soon. Metro trains are the common features in urban areas. Already Delhi has metro train, so is Calcutta, and you know the importance of metro train in the infrastructural development. One such requirement in case of metro trains is tunneling. And please note, if you have to do tunneling in an urban area, just on top there will be tall buildings, there will be important buildings, there will also be very sensitive buildings and weak buildings. You will have to do the tunneling without damaging them, without even causing disturbance to them. So one way of tunneling is make excavations, build the tunnel body and fill up, which is meaningless in urban areas. In some places, all right, it is acceptable, but in many cases you cannot do that way. So when you have to do tunneling, you should know what soil it is, under what situation, under what force you can do the tunneling. It could be a hard rock to soft soil. Hard rock tunneling part is difficult because you require extra force to make the excavations, to make to remove the soil. But in soft soil, the main problem is stability. Even a small amount of removal of soil can cause instability. So you need to protect, you need to hold the soil from falling down. So tunneling requires the knowledge of soil. It requires how much soil is going to fail, what is its strength, and you need to decide about how to make the tunneling, how to make the excavation through them. These are all some of the pictures showing tunneling, and what you see here is lining material. Just on top of these lining materials, you have the soil mass. This may be existing for several meters to several tens of meters, and hence we need to know the strength and deformation properties of the soil mass on top of the tunnel and on the sides of the tunnel, because they are the ones which cause forces on the tunnel. All these things which I mentioned are different types of structures which come on the ground. If at all the ground is weak, in earlier days people would simply discard that site. They say that okay, this site is not suitable, so we will go to another site, we will build our structure on a new site. But these days, you know how valued land is, you just cannot discard a particular site. So what do you do there? The same site, if the soil is bad for foundation, you will have to improve. If the soil is bad from the drainage point of view, you need to improve. If the soil has less impermeability, then again you need to improve. So another new dimension in geotechnical engineering is ground improvement. You can improve the ground to your requirements, and you can improve whatever properties you want. You can improve its safe bearing capacity from the foundation engineering point of view. You can see that it has free drainage. You also can see that the drainage is almost stopped, it is made impermeable. So these are some of the pictures showing different ground improvements techniques. All of them mainly are oriented towards compacting the soil. In the first picture, you have sheep foot rollers which compact clay soil, and in the other picture you have smooth wheeled roller in which normally granular soils are compacted. Also you have impact rollers which not only roll and compact, which provide some kind of impact or dynamic force also, wherein the compaction capabilities are enhanced. The other type of ground improvement technique is dynamic compaction. Extremely simple, but it requires some amount of expertise. You have heavy weights which are dropped from a height using cranes onto the ground. Simply, if you drop several tons of weight onto the ground, depending on the height and depending on the energy, there will be craters formed here. What do I mean by craters formed? The soil which was here, it is displaced, it is compacted, and hence you know you can fill up this crater, thereby overall you are going to have in the same volume more soil put, wherein the density is improved. I tell you, once density is good in granular soils in particular, the strength, stability, durability, all of them will improve. This is one of the ground improvement techniques, and it is called dynamic compaction. Even in this picture you can see the craters formed due to the dropping of heavy weights. You can drop weights of several tons from heights of 25 to 30 meters. Another topic of importance in geotechnical engineering is environmental geotechnics or environmental geomechanics. You know, we do create huge amount of wastes. Waste can be human waste, industrial waste, hospital waste. The objective should be to dispose them off to safe place in such a way that they don't hamper the civilization. We should not simply throw waste outside our house. That is one of our basic requirements. So where do you dispose? You dispose in such a way that overall environment does not suffer. You also will have to dispose in such a way that groundwater is not polluted. So you require many waste disposal landfills. So one such landfill is shown in the picture here. So what is done here is that a landfill is created in such a way that this is an enclosed chamber in which you can place the waste. It is enclosed because whatever waste is here, it should not enter into the groundwater and trouble, affect it. And unnecessarily, the entire area should not be smelly and should not cause problems. So, this enclosed area is prepared out of different types of soils. You can notice here you have a clay liner. So, use clay in such a way that it keeps the entire portion impermeable. So, liquid from here cannot move to the ground, natural ground, or from natural ground also no movement into this portion. So, environmental geotechnics requires quite a lot of the knowledge of geotechnical engineering. You need to know how soil behaves, what kind of chemicals soil contains, and how much these chemicals can affect the soil. And if you have things like waste disposal, there are more number of chemical actions involved, and we need to know how stable, how good the given soil is. I was talking about earthquake when I talked about slope, and earthquake can cause huge problems to all our infrastructure. Here are some of the pictures in which our infrastructure is affected during earthquake. So, the objective is we need to understand the ground, not just under the static load. When the ground is subjected to dynamic force like that of earthquake, will the ground be stable? If not, how we can improve that? And what are the forces at which the ground will become unstable? And what improvement techniques we can think of to enhance the scope of the ground to be stable during earthquake? You can see here the cars are appearing to be taking bath in this water. It used to be a car parking lot before the earthquake. Effect is to cause huge subsidence, and water from below has come down. Here you can see that the railway track looks like a roller coaster. Before the earthquake, it never used to be like that. You can see an elevated bridge, highway, having taken this shape because the pier resting on stable ground became totally out of order. The ground was unstable, and ground uprooted the pier, and the consequence is the elevated road becoming like this. All these are because of bad knowledge about the ground. So, earthquake geotechnical engineering will help us to know how the ground behaves during earthquake. These are again some of the pictures taken after the earthquakes, and you can notice that an earthen dam has failed, and here is a picture in which the bridge has got its deck uprooted. That is because of the instability in the ground which moved these two piers apart. So is the case in this particular bridge. Hence, in general, geotechnical engineering is the in thing an infrastructure requires. What you see is an urban place, and below you have so much activity taking place. It is not just the structure built on ground, it is the structure built inside the ground also. You have the foundations, you have tunnels, you have other soil exploration processes going on all below the ground. So, you will not be surprised in future if we have a city built underground, because that kind of a city can make us safe and stable under many natural and man-made situations. So, all these structures which are buried under river feet are extremely important. They are taking the load of the superstructure, and they are transferring those loads to the soil below. Geotechnical engineer is involved in all these structures. The present day requirement is that we need to go for fabulous buildings, we go for tall structures, we go for structures which look impressive, we go for structures which carry enormous load and which are quite irregular also. So, you have Petronas Tower in Malaysia, which is one of the taller buildings in the world, and naturally it carries heavy and complex loading. The objective of a geotechnical engineer is to transfer these forces stably onto the ground below, and while transferring we have to see whether the ground is okay. One such bad understanding was in case of Leaning Tower of Pisa. The ground was considered to be good, but later on it was found that it causes the structure, that is the tower, to experience settlement in one direction only, which is called differential settlement. And this was all done several centuries before, in 12th to 14th century, where the knowledge of geotechnical engineering was not good, and hence people failed to understand the property of the ground which caused differential settlement. Maybe that blunder has now made Leaning Tower of Pisa a monument. Nowadays we can't risk like that. We need to really understand how the soil is and how durable the structure would be if it is built on it. Can it stand for 100 years? Can it stand for more number of years? Other types of fabulous structures are here. So you have many structures, highways, elevated roads. All of them may look to be in air, but then at some place they will have to be supported on ground. So wherever you seek the support of ground, you need to think of putting the foundation, and geotechnical engineer comes there. He has to decide the type of the foundation. He has to decide how to transfer the forces onto the ground. This type of structure is again not rare these days, because many a times you don't like to build bridges on sea. You would like to take tunnels in deep sea for taking highway from one end to the another end. And what you see here is a link between Denmark and Sweden, where you have elevated bridge for some distance, and from here to here inside the sea there is a tunnel built. So the job of a geotechnical engineer there is to check whether the soil below the sea is good enough to build the tunnel. If not, how to improve that, and what type of tunneling technique is to be followed, and then he has to allow for smooth tunneling activity. My main intention in this lecture was to show you several pictures which show the importance of a geotechnical engineer. Please don't think that only structural engineering is important because you see it on the ground. In fact, you require more knowledge as a geotechnical engineer, because you need to know about the structural forces coming. You also need to know how the ground can take this force. I hope you are satisfied that the geotechnical engineering subject has a significant role to play in the infrastructural development of a country. Please note that it is not just confined to foundation engineering alone. Coming on to what we cover in the next courses, you know geotechnical engineering 2 has 8 units which are divided into two parts, part A and part B. Part A has 4 units covering subsurface exploration, drainage and dewatering, stresses in soil, flow nets. Part B has again 4 units covering lateral earth pressure, stability of slopes, bearing capacity and foundation settlement. As you know, there will be 20 marks or one full question for each of the units, and you will have to answer 5 questions, choosing at least 2 from each of the part. There will be several numerical problems wherever necessary. Each question may have normally 2 to 4 sub questions. Please note all these things which we are covering in geotechnical engineering 2 were seen directly or indirectly in the first part of my lecture, where I showed many applications in terms of different structures. And hence, it is important for you to learn each of the subject carefully. Subsurfaceation is the first thing we need to do. We need to explore the soil. So we need to explore the strength deformation characteristics of soil, for which we either take the samples out of the ground from the place of interest, or we make borehole studies. So subsurface exploration covers various aspects of sampling, how the boring is to be done, what are the what is a bore log, and so on. Then you know what soil is not just soil particles. There will be water moving through it, there will be groundwater in it. So drainage and dewatering is the second part of the syllabus, where you learn about the groundwater table and the determination of groundwater table, what are the different techniques of dewatering during excavation, and which technique is good under what circumstance. Naturally, you have the structure resting on ground, you have the forces coming from structure, and all these forces will cause stresses in soil. And in this chapter, you are going to learn how the stresses are distributed in soil and how to compute the stresses in soil on the depending on the forces coming from the superstructure. Then you have the chapter on flow nets, where you study about water movement through the soil. Soil being porous, if at all there is some difference in head of water between two places, water can move through it. So in this chapter, you are going to learn as to how water moves from one end to the other. Then you have the retaining walls. I showed you plenty of retaining walls, and you need to know that these retaining walls take the pressure from the earth, which acts horizontally. In this chapter, you are going to learn as to how to compute the horizontal pressure and exerted on the retaining wall. Then you saw the failure of slopes. Slopes can fail due to natural and man-made causes. And in this particular chapter, you are going to understand how whether a given slope is stable or not, and you are going to use different techniques to adopt to analyze whether the given slope is stable or unstable. Then you have chapter on bearing capacity of soil. All these structures will cause forces, and these forces have to be transferred to the soil or ground below. And what you are going to see here is whether the soil has got capacity to bear these forces. You are going to compute the bearing capacity of soil. SBC, or safe bearing capacity, is one of the parameters which is vital in determination or in design of foundations. Then you saw earlier how the soil would settle. Soil is a compressible material consisting of solid particles and voids, and these voids may be filled with water, air, or both, and depending on the force on it, soil may get compacted and may experience settlement. You saw the settlement in case of Mexico clay, where you have uniform settlement. You also saw settlement in case of Leaning Tower of Pisa, where you have differential settlement. This chapter will help you to analyze the settlement characteristics of soil, and you are going to compute the total settlement under a given force and see whether they are well within limits. I am happy to mention that we have very dedicated faculty members dealing with different topics: subsurface exploration, drainage and dewatering, stresses in soil will be covered by Professor Nagraj of BMS College of Engineering. Flow nets will be covered by Professor Vijayendra of BIT Bangalore. Lateral earth pressure will be taught by Professor Nanjun Swami of SJCE Mysore. Professor Dinesh of SIT Tumkur will cover the topic of stability of earth slopes. I, SK Prasad, will cover the two topics, bearing capacity of soil and foundation settlement. I wish to inform you that each of this topic is independent and they do not have any prerequisite. Therefore, we have distributed the workload evenly throughout the semester. So even if you study about bearing capacity in the beginning, it's not going to trouble you. So please be careful in having the knowledge of who teaches on which day, and you can establish the continuity. We have worked hard to make this course a very useful one for you. I repeat, the examination system includes 8 questions which will be covered normally from each of the units. First 4 units form part A, the remaining form part B. You have to answer 5 full questions, choosing at least 2 from each of the part. Though literally you can leave a few topics from examination point of view, I advise you to study everything as they are extremely important for your future requirements. Geotechnical engineering 2 is the application of first course which you studied, and as I mentioned, each topic is independent. You can learn all the topics in any order you want. In summary, in this lesson, my main focus was to introduce you to geotechnical engineering. My main focus was to show you the importance of geotechnical engineering and to give you information on future classes in geotechnical engineering too. I just advise you to enjoy this course and learn to your best satisfaction. EduSat coordinators, please send us the feedback at studio@vtu.ac.in. I just repeat, all the coordinators, you can send us your feedbacks at this particular address, studio@vtu.ac.in.